Hello, team.
Yo, yo, yo. Welcome back to the All Purpose Podcast here. My name is Muhammad Haji. To my right, the lovely Hamza Bashir, aka Snapshot Hamza. And off to my left, Auntie Hodan.
Back by popular demand. I'm so gassed.
Oh, 100% it's by popular demand.
I love doing this. I love being here.
Yeah. Oh, it's always such a good vibes, obviously. Yeah. And obviously, you know, we spend so much time before we even record and also after we record just chatting up the entire time.
That's true.
No, so it's absolutely fantastic, man. So it's been a while. Yeah. So let's just kind of get a life update. What have you guys been up to?
Rusty. We're all rusty right now.
A little bit, yeah. The microphone came on and I'm suddenly like...
Just a little nervous now?
You know?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. So what's been going on, Hamza?
What's been going on is, man, in the past, I think we've been gone for like 8 months, man.
Yeah. That's ridiculous.
It's insane, right?
That's crazy.
COVID.
We've been gone 8 months, yeah. I think it's like, I found a little side project I'm doing right now, which is I'm trying to make my own film, right?
Cool.
But I just never knew how exhausting...
Yeah.
Shooting a film, just a scene it will be.
Yeah.
Because usually I'm a photographer guy, right? I come from a photographer background. So what is it? Like 10 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
Yo, I have the camera in the back. 2 seconds, pop, pop, and out.
You're good to go. You're out of
it. And I'm good to go.
Yeah.
Out of the game. But when I'm shooting a scene, I need to make sure I have to move the light. Every single time there's a dialogue going on, for example, I have to put a camera here. When this scene is done, I have to mash the same shot on that side. I have to move the light. I have to talk to the actor. I have to talk to the guy who's shooting it. I have to make sure everything's good. And when I'm shooting outside, the sun moves, the shadows move.
Yeah.
Did you also write the screenplay for the movie?
Yes, I wrote. Yeah, I'm originally exact. I have to write it, so I have to put on a writer hat, director hat,
everything,
DP hat.
Just imagine what actual directors, producers, or writers have to deal with whenever they're, you know.
Look, I was talking to Luqman. Luqman said they have people. What I was doing was I was doing 10 people's jobs.
Yeah, they have someone doing each different job
in the set. What I was doing is like everybody was just doing one specific thing.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Definitely, definitely.
But I've been doing that and I've been writing a lot. So I write my own stories.
Yeah,
so. The things I want to write in a form where I can adapt to a screenplay.
Okay.
First, I write in a novel format, like a short story.
Mm-hmm.
Put myself in a situation, and then I try to adapt to it. Other than that, man, just school, adapting.
So talk to us. You know, obviously, you picked up this new passion, this new hobby. We need something to look forward to. Like, do you have something? Do you have a date you want to drop on us right now?
When can we expect the snapshot feature film?
I don't have a specific date right now.
Okay. Breaking news, by the way, guys.
I don't have a specific date, but what I can tell you is. I'm putting my heart and soul into this project. So
okay.
It's going to be good.
Inshallah.
I want the story to be as good as the visuals.
Yeah.
I don't want one carrying the other.
Definitely, definitely. Right? So, all right, we're definitely looking forward to it.
Absolutely.
So Hodan, talk to us about yourself. What you been up to? First of all, Hodan is Miss Travel, Miss International. I've never
Hodan dropped her ATV photo in the group chat. I'm like, like the coolest photo I've seen.
And then all of a sudden,
year.
she's in the sand dunes of Dubai. I'm like, what's going on here? Parasailing like Mount Everest. Like, I don't know what's going on.
You guys, let me tell you something. Every single trip that I've been on this year has been completely impromptu except for the first one. Everything that I've done, every place I've gone, I've decided maybe a day, 2 days before.
You're like, I'm just going to go.
Yeah, we should go. Let's do it.
Interesting.
Okay. And I've gotten into the habit now where I act first and then I'm like, okay, well, then let's figure out the details later.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Because if I don't act and cut that ticket,
then
it's not going to happen.
Yeah, it's just going to drag on. It's going to drag on.
So I'm just doing that. And I have a lot more planned this year, inshallah. I've been to 4 out of 6 inhabitable continents this year.
Wow.
I want to go to all 6.
That's wild.
Okay.
Well, so what are the 2 left on your list?
Australia and South America.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Are there any specific places you want to go? South America obviously has a ton of countries there. Is there country specific?
In South America, I would really my goal, my target is to hit Uruguay and Buenos Aires in Argentina.
In Argentina, yeah.
Very cool cities with lots of history, interesting architecture, amazing food, amazing people.
Yeah.
I just want to
Messi's from there, by the way, so.
Messi's from Argentina. That
Miss
is
from
true.
Argentina.
Who?
Yeah. Messi. Lionel Messi.
Yeah.
Anyway, that guy's from I'm gone.
Yeah.
You got me sold.
Okay. Yeah. Listen. Group trip on the way, guys.
That's gonna pull up on you in Australia, though.
Yeah, man. The
and
wildlife.
Those huge spider that
I'm just gonna go in like a bubble suit.
Yeah.
Nothing will touch me.
Well, it's terrifying.
They said there's a. You know how we have a spring. They have a spider season.
Yeah.
So when you wake up in the morning, the whole grass instead of having dew, like you know, wake up with dew on the grass.
Yeah.
They decided like, it's okay. It's normal.
It's insane.
Imagine we could have spider webs everywhere.
I saw this video on Twitter recently, maybe last week. There was a teenage girl fighting with a bear in her backyard in Australia. The bear was trying to
insane.
Eat her dog or something.
Yeah, she was fighting.
I'm like, is this normal? Like, she really like hit him with like a two piece and the biscuit and went on her way. I'm like, what in the world is going on over there?
I feel like at that point, like, my dog has served his or her purpose. Yes. Like, just, you took it for the team. I appreciate you. You know what I mean?
Let me lock these doors.
Our loyal friend. Mm-hmm.
She went out and actually fought off a bear.
Amazing how, I mean, I do have a pet, but I'm not even going to get into this right now. I can't imagine putting my life at risk for a pet. I really cannot.
Not in the slightest.
Maybe I'm not like,
oh my God,
as much of a loving pet parent as I could be.
That's insane. You know? No, I've heard many people say they'd actually go into a burning building to save their pet because it's like their child.
Yeah. Oh, like, yeah, you see it in movies.
You're going a little bit too far.
Hi, enough child though. I love my wife, you know?
I respect that. I respect that.
I can't do it. I can't lie to you guys. Yeah.
You're making literally the right decision.
Decision. Ultimately.
100%.
What's up with you? Have in the past year?
Yeah, had you?
Yeah,
you
man.
Us.
I graduated. From Master, alhamdulillah. That was stressful, and I also got married in the last year as well. So that was huge news.
Let's see the hand. Let's see the left hand.
Mama, see you ladies. Nah. Alhamdulillah. It was beautiful, man. It was beautiful. Obviously, you guys were there in support, so I definitely appreciate you guys. But yeah, man, it's been beautiful, man. Even though obviously, you know, kind of COVID kind of took things, you know, made things a little difficult. At the end of it, it was still beautiful to kind of, you know, the outcome of what happened. So, thank God, man. Praise be to God, man.
Yeah, congratulations, man.
Yeah.
You did two big things in 1 year.
You really did. Yeah. That's incredible. Wild. You knocked those two major milestones.
Time's flying. I'm just following Ayub's footsteps. That's what Ayub did.
And shout out to Hodan and Nisa, right? Too.
Well, let's calm down. Now,
you know what's next,
a child is what you're saying is next? Well,
we want to be uncles and aunties.
Let's pump the brakes on
that.
That's
what we need, right?
I'm trying to enjoy my youth. You know what I mean? I need to travel a little bit more. I need to,
He said youth.
Are you saying I'm old?
Hella, had you.
I'm a middle-aged man now.
You, bro. That ring put 5 years on him.
That's what it was. It's the ring. Yeah, you've aged like 7 years.
That's wild. I guess I just got to go golfing on the weekends now. I guess that's what.
When you put the ring on, you start to age in dog years. That's what happens. So,
it's so drastic.
I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry.
A year is seven all.
So now you're 39. That's, you know? So sorry, Haji.
Are you the funny thing?
Well, it happened.
Well, yeah, first of all, shout out to Hodan and Anissa as well.
Yes, congratulations, sir.
Another one of our, you know, our close friends also got. Dude, this year has been insane.
You guys got the Mayor and Balakir, good bug, bro.
That's wild, man.
Oh, my God.
Everybody's catching
up. I'm looking at two of y'all right now. What's going on?
Don't look me in the eyes, Haji. Don't do that.
Not at this very moment. Right. Now, but obviously, you know, we've seen each other over this past year, and you know, we stayed close and in touch. But unfortunately, we decided to take a big break from recording episodes and shooting and so on and so forth. But now we're back, and today, you know, obviously, it was highly requested that we get Hodan back on. Highly requested. Everyone's blowing up Hamza's DM saying, yo, we absolutely love the episode with Hodan and how she was able to, you know, portray the story. And I forgot what the story was.
Israel Keys was
the murder or the, you know, the serial killer that Hodan talked about. And it was just insane. You're like, you know, fantastic storyteller, mashallah.
Thank you.
But yeah, you're highly requested. And so today we're also going to be doing that as well. We're going to be doing a murder mystery, actually, or it's just a mystery is what this episode is going to be about. And so today, so Paul, then please take the floor.
The floor is all yours.
Thank you, guys. First of all, I'm happy to be here. Thank you for having me once again. This will be my podcast at the end of the episode. 100%. Just know, now it's mine.
Well, it's been yours.
Okay, so today, guys, when I figured out, when you guys told me about the topic, I'm like, okay, what can I do? What can I pull out of my bag to wow you guys, razzle-dazzle you today, right? So I went and searched the deep crevices of my mind. I'm like, I remember hearing about that one time. Let me tell you guys the story of the Dyatlov Pass incident.
All right.
Are you familiar? Ever heard of it?
I've heard of it. I don't know the actual details of it, but I do know that there were, I believe, was it like some 9 hikers or something like that, who, it was in Russia, the Dyatlov.
Yeah.
And that they died. That's all I know about it.
Let's unpack and discuss.
All right.
Please. I have no knowledge.
Okay. Amazing. Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, you'll be fully well versed at the end of the podcast, inshallah. Perfect. Okay. So with that being said, so the Dyatlov Pass incident, Mind you, Dyatlov is named after that pass, that area in the mountains of Russia is named after the group leader, the first person essentially who died in this case.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And so, okay, so just some background information. This story takes place in January of 1959. There were 10 hikers originally who were college students. They're just, you know, regular college students, but they were very experienced hikers and they were very familiar with the outdoors and they could hold their own. So when they had a break in January of 1959 from school, this group of 10 hikers decided, let's go on an expedition. Let's go test ourselves to see if we can make it through the Siberian wilderness in the dead of winter.
Absolutely wild. And that's crazy.
Yeah. I mean, couldn't be me. That's all I have to say.
I'd like to do this for fun.
We got the African body. Yeah. So.
That's what it is. My African DNA will never allow it.
Yeah.
Siberia? February? That's ridiculous.
No, thank you.
Even in June, it's cold.
Oh, my.
Listen, guys, that's neither here nor there. Couldn't be me, but we move.
Yeah.
So, with that being said, so these 10 hikers decided to take this trek. It was over 100 kilometers that they had to walk through, essentially, to get to their end point. They never made it.
Wow.
And so basically what happened was, well, let me tell you about the hikers just a little bit. Like I said, they are college students. They're all friends. Uh-huh. And eight men and two women, total of 10, right? And so, excuse me, I'm like looking at my notes.
No, don't take time.
You said there were 10, right?
Like I said, it happened in the Ural Mountains of Russia. And let's just get into the story. That was just the background information, guys. I'm sorry. Okay. So the day that they were leaving to their trip, it was January 23rd of 1959. Everything seemed to be going all right. Everything was fine. They had a specific route planned, and their route was pre-approved by other people, essentially. So they said, it's difficult, but you guys are able to do it because you're so experienced. They were very confident that they could execute this mission because of their experience and such. So they get on a bus. They drive on the bus. They get off the bus. They have to take a train. They get off the train. They have to go on horse and buggy. After they do the horse and buggy, then they have to trek an additional, I believe it was 130 kilometers to get to their end destination.
Yeah.
Couldn't be me, right?
Yeah, that's insane.
It was a very taxing, like physically taxing journey.
Yeah.
Okay, so basically, they're, you know, boop, 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 doing their thing. They're on this trek. At first, originally, it ended up being that they were doing fine. They were doing great and everything. One of the hikers, there was one individual. He started out as 10. His name was Yuri. This man had previous health conditions. He had an issue with his knee, had an issue with his heart, but he turned back. So he turned back. Okay. And so he told the leader of the group, his name was Igor Dyatlov. He's like, hey, gotta go, gotta blast, you know, don't feel too good. Igor told Yuri, he said, hey, if we're not back by February 12th, something's going on. Okay. Come check, essentially, right?
It ended up from 10 to 9.
I'm sorry?
That's how it ended up from 10 to 9 individuals who passed away?
Yes, that's exactly. One thing that saved his life. It's actually incredible.
Wow.
And so he turned back thinking that the hikers would be back home by the 12th, right?
Okay.
On the 26th of February, when they didn't hear anything from them, everyone freaked out. Okay. You know, they're like, wait a second, maybe a day late, 2 days late, perhaps, right? But to be over 10 days late to come back, there's something going on. Yeah. With that being said, what happened next was the family of the hikers decided to let authorities know, essentially, and so a rescue team was sent out. What they found confusing, number one,
okay,
and horrific. All when they went to they took the same route that the hikers originally told people that they were going to take.
Yeah,
and so they found originally 3 bodies. Right. 3 bodies, mind you. Mind you, this is the winter of
Siberia.
You know what I mean? They found these bodies undressed. Like no cold weather gear, no shoes, nothing, just like t-shirts and like underwear.
That's insane.
Why? Why would that happen? Right? And so they're dead. One is facing down, like face down. One is, and then 2 of them are, there's a tree and they're under the tree. The tree branches on the lower half were basically ripped off. You know what I mean?
Okay.
And that suggests that they were either both or one of them was climbing the tree, but the reason behind it is a little interesting. It could be one of two things. Number one, one of them was trying to climb the tree just so they could look out into the distance, see if they could potentially find their campsite, et cetera. Makes sense, right? For sure,
yeah, yeah.
But the way that the tree was climbed, you know, when analysts basically looked deep into this, it was rough. It suggested rushing, right?
Okay.
So if someone is basically running and trying to rush up a tree, that means they're what? Running from something. You know what I mean?
Okay.
And the information I'm about to give you, it goes this way and that way and all of it's a lot to make sense of, okay, you know, okay.
Yeah, but yeah.
You know, do with it what you will. So there's three bodies. Those are the first three. A little ways down the mountain, essentially, the rescue team found footprints, and the footprints in the snow, it suggested that those people were walking. They're walking. But then there's others. The other three were running up a tree, like trying to run and get up a tree.
Okay.
Things aren't making sense.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they go down the mountain. Oh, by the way, backstory. These people decided to, the mountain range that they're in, it's the Ural Mountains, but there's one particular mountain where they made their camp. It's called Dead Mountain. Okay. Now you tell me.
Who would willingly go?
Who's gonna sleep at Dead Mountain?
Yeah,
I just don't get it. But
you know what? I feel like this is a good camping site. Moment, let's just stay here for the night.
The moment you tell me
I have to go to Dead Mountain.
Mm-hmm. Oh my god!
The moment you tell me I have to go from a car to a train to another out of town.
A car, a train, a horse and buggy. It's too much.
I would have tapped out a long time ago.
I know. But anyway, they do a little bit more research and they're like looking, you know? And so a ways down the way, they found the other four bodies. Mind you, all nine of them are dead. I have to say that, I have to preface that. Uh-huh. Everybody was dead except that guy who turned back. But they're all dead in different ways, different positionings. Things are, it just doesn't make sense. And crime scene photos will be
inserted here.
Inserted above type of thing. So they found the other four bodies. All of them are different places. They're in the same general area, but they're one's here, one's there. You know what I mean? It doesn't make any sense. They found the tent that they were sleeping in, right? The tent that they were sleeping in was actually ripped, like sliced open from the inside. So one of the hikers that was inside the tent, presumably sleeping normally, something happened that made them panic so bad that they could not get their clothes on, couldn't put their winter clothes on, and they couldn't open the zipper of the door.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So they had to slash out and literally
do the dash
type of thing. Confusing. Let me take a moment here to ask you guys, like, do you have any questions so far? What do you think? Like, where do you think this is heading?
So far we've mentioned we've accounted for seven bodies, right?
Excuse me, nine. So there's nine? Four, pardon there's me, 30... four and five. Totaling nine. There's four that were found.
Okay.
There was four that were found. The first original four, there was two. Sorry, I kept saying three, but I literally meant four.
Four, okay. Yeah.
The first four were all down, all dead, and they're the ones who were climbing the tree, trying to climb the tree, allegedly.
Okay. Yeah.
The medical examiner, once the autopsies were done, you know, the medical examiner concluded that they died of hypothermia. That's those four.
Okay.
The other five died of blunt force trauma, essentially. And
do they know what type of object?
Let me tell you, there's a lot going on here, okay?
Go ahead.
But right now, like our thought, like my thoughts on this is insane. You know, obviously, you know, you're a hiker, so on and so forth. This is your passion. You know, I understand why they'd go out to Siberia and then obviously, you know, do this pass.
Go to Dead Mountain.
Yeah, but.
Go to Dead Mountain.
Yeah, Dead Mountain, that's, I'd like to know the history of Dead Mountain. You know what I mean?
So
like,
Mountain,
why is it called Dead Mountain?
Dead Mountain is called Dead Mountain by the indigenous people that live there. Right.
Okay.
So there's a specific group of people called the Monsi people. There, in my research, one thing that I found was before, in the past, the Monsi people are they're an isolated group of people for the most part. You know what I mean? But they have stories and they have folklore about things that happen in the Dead Mountain. So
gotcha.
Many people have either, you know, died or disappeared there.
Yeah,
so
it's that's like why the Bermuda Triangle in a sense.
It's okay. It's not as obviously, you know,
yeah.
prolific as that,
yeah,
but
yeah.
it's still somewhere I wouldn't want to be caught.
For
dead,
sure,
honestly.
For sure. Yeah, yeah.
So The five bodies, were they found inside the tent or somewhere else?
No, nobody was inside the tent. All five of the bodies were outside the slash tent. And so one of the bodies was missing a tongue. The tongue had been ripped out of the woman. It was one of the girls. Her tongue had been ripped out of her mouth. She was also missing her eyeballs. She didn't have any eyeballs in her sockets.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah, I had to just check to see if I had mine for a
second. You're good, bro.
Well, you actually touched them.
What? God.
They're there.
What?
She was missing both of her eyes. She was missing a tongue. And she had four or five broken ribs.
Wow.
Like not just broken. Shattered. Like smashed, shattered. Right? Another person was also, one of the other guys was also missing his eyeballs as well, but his tongue was intact, luckily for him. One guy died, according to the medical examiner, he died due to his skull being crushed. And it was, his skull was crushed in a way, not even in a way, with the amount of force that it would take to crush a skull, it's beyond what a human
is able to do.
Okay. Right?
That's...
Like scientifically, a human cannot crush this man's skull like this.
Yeah, with that much force.
Things, again, not adding
one
up.
One last question. Can I ask you a question?
Mm-hmm.
Are there any people that live around that area that they're camping at?
The Mansi people, the indigenous tribe, live in the area, but they're familiar. They've been there for thousands and thousands of years. These people, these hikers.
And they're not suspect of this situation?
Nope.
Why not? Why won't you suspect them?
Why would the Mansi people be suspicious of what's going on?
Why wouldn't the authorities suspect the Mansi people?
I honestly don't think that's... I didn't come across that.
Yeah.
I didn't come across
that. That would be a logical situation, right?
We'll get into the theories and everything after this. Okay, I'm just trying to set the scene here.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
So the other guy was missing his eyeballs. His ribs were also shattered. One guy had his skull literally caved in. And then one of the girls was face down, dead, hurt, there was severe hemorrhaging and all sorts of things on the inside, but on the outside she appeared fine. She had everything, like her eyes and her tongue, unlike some of the others. So they all died in various painful ways. I feel like the other four, the medical examiner said that they died of hypothermia. These five died of, I'm sorry, there's a specific something that the medical examiner said that I thought was really interesting. Basically, blunt force trauma, unexplained blunt force trauma.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Another thing that was very interesting that's going to throw you guys off, Hamza. Uh-huh. The two hikers, the four that were found originally, two of them were found to, their articles of clothing, three of the articles of clothing that they had were found to be radioactive.
Oh, wow.
What?
That's
radioactive.
Very odd, yeah. Uh-huh. And what year was this again?
1959.
Okay. Mm-hmm. The reason why Hodan pointed at Hamza was because Hamza actually told us to watch this, you know, this documentary, this movie or the show, this miniseries called Chernobyl. And if some of you don't know Chernobyl, essentially it happened in Ukraine where there was, you know, a nuclear power plant that exploded and
the worst nuclear disaster in history.
Yeah. Yeah. And so I was just making sure that
the timeline. Yeah, that's the reference. Yeah. So yeah, has the radioactivity.
The radioactivity.
Three of their articles of
clothing. Professor Lasgov, right?
Yeah.
I forget his name.
Yeah.
That guy was the real
one. So we know for sure that Chernobyl has nothing to do with why they were radioactivity.
This has nothing to do with that. Okay. Chernobyl was 1986. That took place.
Correct.
This is 1959.
Yeah.
Okay. So totally
still
different
during the Cold War, though, right?
It is.
Cold War started in 60, probably.
No, Cold War was around that time.
This is
we're saying Russia, but this is the Soviet Union.
Correct.
At this time.
Right.
So anyway, three of their articles of clothing were found to be radioactive. How, where, when,
what,
how, it didn't make any sense.
Yeah.
Do you know what clothing specifically?
It was two shirts and a pair of pants that belonged to two of the original, the first four.
The hypothermia people.
Yeah, the four who died from hypothermia, two of them, three of their articles of clothing were found to be radioactive.
That's so odd.
It doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
It just doesn't. There could be. There's just so much, you know?
Yeah.
Right.
Hypothermia, blunt force trauma. How did this happen?
Yeah.
So, you know, so many theories exist out.
Do you know how far apart their bodies were?
So with the first group and the second group, I believe it was about a distance of 1,300 feet, and it was down the slope of a mountain.
Okay.
So if you were standing with the first four, you wouldn't be able to see the one, the five at the bottom.
Yeah.
The bottom.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. So
they had to go down.
Okay.
And it was. There's lots of snow, obviously.
Yeah.
Visibility isn't that great, 100%. Obviously.
Yeah, definitely makes sense.
So there's lots of theories when it comes to this. What happens? Like, what's going on? You know what I mean? Like, what could it possibly be? One of the theories. Well, let me ask you guys before I even get into that. What do you guys think happened? What's your thought process like right now?
I am suspecting the locals.
You suspect the locals?
Yeah.
Well, for the individuals to rip their clothes off and to kind of just run out, and I feel like maybe there was some sort of hallucinogen that they took, some sort of drugs that they took for them to kind of react in that manner. And for the others, maybe the other five, maybe was there some sort of animal? I felt like if there was like a bear or something, would probably see claw marks, you know?
You'd see that.
Yeah, but to be specifically their tongue and their eyeballs, it's odd. And I don't know if an animal would be
I'm going to rule out the animals for you completely, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Had it been a bear, a wolf, something like that, you would have
seen blood. Bodies. You would have,
You know?
That's, true.
You would not see any bodies.
Yeah,
They would be eaten. You'd know it was an animal 100%. Attack, essentially, right? It wasn't an animal.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. What was the other thing?
The first one I said probably like some sort of drugs that they for the individuals that were that died of hypothermia. The four, maybe they took some sort of drugs which made them overreact and try to run up a tree.
They didn't. With the medical examiner, obviously he did a toxicology screen.
Yeah.
There was nothing in their system except a little bit of alcohol.
Okay.
A little bit of alcohol to kind of I guess warm them up or something during the cold.
Yeah, yeah.
But that was it. They were asleep and they, what I think. Is that they were asleep and, you know, obviously something happened, whatever the case may be. But the reason why that they didn't have clothes on, it wasn't because that they were high or hallucinating or anything.
Yeah.
There's this, there's something called paradoxical undressing when it comes to hypothermia.
Okay.
Essentially, and I literally wrote it down to explain it in like layman's terms.
Yeah, for sure.
When an individual is experiencing very cold temperatures, their brain acts the opposite. Like your body feels so hot that you have to start removing your clothes.
Oh,
so that is them being undressed and in their underwear and their, you know, sleeping clothes.
Because of how cold it was.
Yeah, paradoxical undressing could explain that. But again, that's just a theory. It could really be that something else was going on.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Because obviously we've seen, you know, so many times where, you know, sometimes, you know, like on a toxicology report, something's not found at that moment because it's not something that they're looking for or something that's, you know, after the fact. And
no, I think that's one of the things that they were looking for. It like drugs, alcohol,
all that.
Some sort of something that could potentially explain, you know, the actions of the hikers.
Yeah, yeah.
But there was nothing in their system. It's just that their brain was leading them to believe that their bodies are burning.
Yeah.
So they're removing all of the clothes.
That's
and
wild.
Stuff. But you see how there's I'm telling you one thing and another thing. None of this is fitting.
Yeah, none of it connects. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Nothing. To this day, I need you to know this is unsolved.
Oh, okay.
Completely unsolved.
Yeah.
Right. So let's get into the theories. One thing that's it seems plausible, I think that when you think about it, you could, you know, you might think, okay, this makes sense, whatever. But when you look into the details, it's kind of debunked, you know. People have said that these people, that the hikers died due to an avalanche. That's one of the main theories. An avalanche happened. They were essentially, the snow crushed these people, and the snow did all of that to them. Doesn't make any sense, right?
They would have been covered by the snow.
But, and guess what? The avalanche theory is actually something that was pushed by, like, the Soviet government. You know what I mean?
Okay.
They said there's no foul play here. There's nothing
what
going
about
on.
The tongues and the eyeballs.
Yeah. An avalanche does that all of a sudden?
It's a little bit suspicious. How does an avalanche trip out a tongue and an eyeball?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
it doesn't make sense. So we're just going to move on. I don't believe that one.
Nah, same.
Okay, so around this time, I believe it was about 2 days before the hikers actually made it to their camp, there were some, and don't laugh, guys, okay? There were some UFO sightings in the area.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah, all right.
So I believe it was something around 600 people reported sightings of a UFO, like, over the mountains in this area, you know?
Okay.
We don't know. We just don't know if it was a bright light or actual UFO. Who's to say it, right? But I don't know about you guys. I believe in aliens. I do. You know, I'm not sure what we don't know what kind of technology that they have, yeah. what they're capable of, whatever the case may yeah. be. It could very well have been a UFO that has come down and killed these people with like an otherworldly like force type of thing. You know, could have been anything. Aliens are another one. The one that I actually think makes sense might seem a little bit ridiculous to you guys.
Let's hear it.
Another theory.
So an avalanche and aliens is not ridiculous. This is ridiculous.
This one's kind of crazy.
Looking forward to hearing. Looking forward to it.
One theory is that these people were victims of a Yeti. Like a Chewbacca type of character. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And let me tell you why I think that it makes sense. I'm going to tell you why I think it makes sense. Okay? All right. A Yeti, right? It's like superhuman, essentially.
Like a Bigfoot, right? Yeah.
Like a Bigfoot type of situation, you know? Obviously, if they're in the area, you know, those, they're like indigenous, I guess is the word, to the, you know, to the area and such. They are able to adapt to the cold better, and they know their way around. And if they're, you know, a Bigfoot type of creature would obviously be a lot stronger than a human.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's why I think that maybe they came across some sort of suspicious
human-like
animal.
I feel like if there was a Yeti, though, mm-hmm. I understand maybe the physical damage that happened to the five individuals, you know, 1,300 feet away down, you know, mm-hmm. down the mountain or whatever, mm-hmm. you know, with someone's skull crushed in eyeballs. So I would understand that. But for the individuals that died of hypothermia, mm-hmm. you know,
I think it's plausible.
Okay.
I told you before that there's two groups of bodies found.
Correct.
Originally four who were kind of up the mountain mm-hmm. a bit, and then the other five were down the mountain.
Yeah.
The original four, I have no idea. I have to say, with this case, there's so many questions. There's a lot more questions than there are answers.
Yeah.
So not everything makes sense, but what could possibly have happened is that the Yeti basically caught those five on their ones. You know what I mean? On their ones. And he struck then.
Yeah.
Or they either came across the Yeti and that's when he struck, you know? I will say when the bodies were found, the five that were hurt, essentially, they were all in, it looked as though they were running in different directions. So one is here running towards the camp. Another one is over here, but they're also running towards the camp. Does that make sense? The way that the way that the bodies were placed suggests that they were running or like going back to where they came from.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So I'm thinking something maybe approached them from behind.
Yeah.
Or whatever the case may be, and they tried to run away, and they got essentially. I don't know. The Yeti, Chewbacca, Bigfoot theory makes sense to me. It's like one and two, so it's three.
Yeah.
I get it. You know, like, I don't, it just but makes sense.
You would have thought they would have found footprints for the Yetis, though.
But you have to think, though, the rescue mission people, they got to them. Almost the bodies were discovered February 26th.
Yeah.
The hikers are believed to have died February 1st.
Oh, wow. So that's
so nice. And this is February. It's the wintertime. Snow, rain, whatever the case may be, could have completely wiped those.
Yeah.
Okay. Makes sense.
Those footprints away, you know? Or maybe they saw a footprint and assumed it was an animal print or something like that. Lots of things I feel like could explain that away.
Wow, interesting.
So yeah, those are the three, I guess, ridiculous ones. another theory is that, so in the mountains of the Ural Mountains of Russia, mind you, like you said, Hadji, this takes place during the Cold War. Mm-hmm. Cold War era, it's 1959. It's right after World War II. U.S. and Soviet Union are you know, race against arms. All sorts of things are happening. You know what I'm saying? Oh. It's been said that this area of Russia has been used previously in the past for nuclear testing.
Oh,
like weapons
which
testing.
Could explain the
radioactivity, right? But why three articles of clothing that belong to two people and not all of them?
That's true.
Why is the area not radioactive?
Yeah.
Okay. Like nothing else was found that's radioactive except those three articles of clothing. You know what I'm saying?
That's odd, yeah.
It's odd. So many questions. So that area was used previously in the past as like weapons testing, nuclear testing, whatever the case may be.
Okay.
So radioactivity, as we've seen in Chernobyl and, you know, all sorts of things just in history in general, there's a lot, there's lots of like consequences, you know
yeah.
what I mean?
Yeah.
Mutation, people getting sick, people die, all sorts of things, you know what I'm saying? And so when these, the theory basically states that these hikers came across an area of land that they shouldn't have been on. Does that make sense?
Okay. Like Area 51, maybe?
Like Area 51 type of situation.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
And the theory is essentially that they saw something that they shouldn't have, and the Russian government staged this wild...
Elaborate.
I think that makes more sense than the other two theories.
That's you. It doesn't make sense to
it's
me.
It's the Yeti for me.
It's the Yeti for me. No, I swear.
No, that's wild. I'm definitely siding with Hamza on this one in regards to that last theory. Probably makes, you know, the most sense that they, you know, obviously educated college students, you know, maybe they seen something that they didn't see, you know, that they weren't supposed to see. And the Russian government had to be like, hey, you got to go, you got to go.
Yeah. And with the, and you know, touching back on the radioactivity thing, at their funeral, right, the, I believe it was three of them during their showing, like the viewing of the, like the body, their skin was glowing like an orange, like a little, there was like a glow. It was the people who were at the funeral, like it's been said that they were freaked out. They're like, why is this
person
glowing like a pale orange? You know?
Yeah.
Weird. So many questions that I do not have the answers to, unfortunately.
What a shame.
Oh, it's a shame, right? Yeah, so.
So what is your theory?
My theory is the Yeti. I think Chewbacca whooped their ass. Like, no cap.
Chewbacca
really
caught you lacking.
He really caught them slipping. No, like, that's really what I think happened.
But what would make you think that the four guys that were running to the tree, why would they just constantly keep climbing?
But the paradoxical dressing that Holden mentioned, maybe they were just hallucinating. Man. Maybe the Chewbacca didn't come for them, and they were hallucinating, and they died of hypothermia. While Chewbacca caught the other five lacking.
Mm-hmm. But I will say with this coroner, the medical examiner, people have kind of been on his case a little bit because it seems as though it's been said that he could potentially be in cahoots with whoever it is. Possible. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because the injuries that the five were sustained on their on the actual medical report, like the coroner's examination, it's not as detailed as the report isn't as detailed as actually what was seen on the bodies. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So the coroner is reporting ripped eye sockets and, you know, a ripped out tongue. But what he's not reporting is essentially her, like, throat is missing. You get what I'm saying?
Or glowing orange.
Glowing orange skin.
Oh, yeah.
It's things like that he's not explaining
or
doesn't have the answer to, or maybe doesn't want to give the answer to.
Awesome.
So people have been suspicious about the medical examiner as well.
Yeah.
Who's to say? It could tie into the nuclear testing and the
theory,
the weapon.
Yeah,
the
I
government.
Think that makes sense. Yeah, the, you know, the Russian government would be like, hey.
Yeah.
What's up?
You know, usually with guys, when it comes to like mysteries and, you know, just recording in general, I really do generally like to be prepared, and I like to be able to give you a direct answer when you ask me a question.
Yeah.
But this is not one of those stories where I can do that.
Yeah.
I have the same questions that you guys have. Everyone in the world has the same questions that we
it's
have.
It's one of the biggest
Where's
unsolved
the guy
mysteries?
That survived?
He the one guy, he didn't obviously see anything. He went back before they made it to their campsite. So he went back, like, remember how I said they were on a train and the bus or whatever?
Yeah.
He got off after the train. He went back after the train.
Yeah.
He didn't get on the horse and buggy.
But you know what sucks, though? You know what sucks about this case?
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, people died. You know, that's very sad.
That's tragic.
But what they named, they called it the Dyatlov Pass. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, like, they named it after the guy, the leader of the pack, instead of, you know, the rest. That sucks. Like, you know, you're not remembered.
No, yeah.
What a
See,
shame.
The thing
Eight
is,
other people, no one care about them.
I've been doing research on this for, like, 2 days now, and I don't even know their names. Like, I know the guy, Igor Dyatlov.
Igor
Dyatlov. Because of the, you know, the name.
Dyatlov sounds so
familiar. But I cannot, and they're Russian names also, guys. Yeah. It's hard to remember.
They probably said Dyatlov sounds easy. It's
Dyatlov probably is probably, I swear, Dyatlov is actually the easiest name to pronounce of all of them.
Yeah. Okay. That's probably right. That's
so, yeah, I wish I could put a nice little bow on this for you and just sum it up nicely and just let it, you know.
But that's just not the case.
But that's just not the case.
That's so unfortunate.
And technology wasn't prevalent back in the day, too.
If you think, and it's crazy to think that now so much more happens now where, you know, they now have DNA where that they're able to go back and they can search DNA and they can check, you know, fingerprints or whatever the case may be, yeah. and arrest a lot of these individuals or free a lot of the individuals who got arrested for, you know, who were wrongly convicted and so on and so forth. Exactly. So technology and science has definitely grown so much since then. So I can only imagine what they would have been able to, if they still have the proper, I don't know, maybe.
If only,
yeah.
Yeah. So guys, that is the interesting, weird
conundrum
of the Dyatlov Pass incident. That's, do you have any questions before me?
Of course, I have hundreds of questions.
Okay, you tell. Let me see if I can answer them for you as best as I can.
I don't think they're answerable questions, though. My question is, first of all, when was the KGB formed?
The KGB, I don't know exactly when it was
formed. After the Cold War, right? Or before?
It was after the Cold War. The KGB was in existence at this time.
It wasn't, right?
It was in existence.
Yeah.
Okay. That would make sense.
Yeah. Because they were definitely active during the Cold War.
Yeah. To expand back, on the government nuclear testing theory, it said that it's actually the KGB that was basically sent over by the government to deal with these people type of thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Why would they put on a dramatic show like that?
Couldn't tell you. It doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
You'd think they would want to maybe keep it quiet, keep it.
I'm still
nice
suspecting the indigenous people, bro.
You think so?
You think the indigenous people?
You think they would? I feel like, why would they do something like that?
For what?
Yeah.
Why would they go to Dead Mountain?
Hundreds of people come by, try and do this trek. No issues with them. All of a sudden they catch
one of them snapped, bro. One family just snapped.
It's possible that they named it Dead Mountain because that's what they do. They smoke people there.
Yeah.
That's possible. I feel like, Hamza, you might be onto something.
That Dyatlov Pack, huh?
Yeah.
The Dyatlov Pack. That's what we're looking at.
Wow.
No, but the reason why I don't think that it's the indigenous people is because, touching back to the people who were actually, like, who died of the injuries, again, it was a force that a human cannot, like,
it's like,
do. A human can't do
it's
it.
It's like squishing a grape, squishing the, breaking
like
the
that.
Yeah, that's insane.
The
amount of force you have to properly squish a head, a skull.
Yeah.
And all the, that's insane.
Crush it. Yeah. Crush someone's ribs, literally crush them.
Yeah.
To pull out your tongue so fast and so hard that a part of your throat is ripped out with it. To pull out eyeballs out of the eye sockets. It's not human like.
Just disgusting.
It's not human.
Yeah. Imagine you're the person, like, you see it, like you're probably next.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But imagine what's going through your head, bro. Now it justifies why those guys were just running up the tree.
I will say, guys, years and years later, they interviewed the family of Igor Dyatlov, the leader,
mm-hmm.
and his family thinks that it was a government conspiracy. His family believes that.
Wow.
Yeah, they think that there was something to do.
Some foul play.
Still
foul
unsolved, play. Right?
Uh-huh.
It's unsolved. It's an unsolved
mystery.
To
this day, it's unsolved.
Yeah.
Completely unsolved.
That's wild, man.
I don't know how you can follow that up, bro.
It's so interesting. You're like, I want to find out more.
I just hope we
figure it out before something
we die.
Happens.
Before, yeah. We just need to, they need to solve this mystery before I die.
Yeah,
that's
it. Yeah.
I'm not asking for too much,
I'm not
right?
Asking for yeah,
it's
yeah,
not
yeah,
a lot.
Yeah. That's wild, yo.
Yeah, guys.
Man, the Dyatlov Pass. Fantastic sharing that, Hodan. Thank you for answering all our questions.
Oh, absolutely.
Man, this is insane. I'd love to know more.
Yeah, do some research into it. You
yeah.
know?
Oh my goodness.
I don't know how you can follow that up, bro.
Well, I can't follow that up. Thank you guys for listening. This is great. So the mystery that I'm talking about today, Holden had a mystery. I'm talking about a murder mystery today, and it is the Black Dahlia. So some of you may know of the Black Dahlia. It's a very, very popular case, but we're just going to go over it, talk a little bit about it. And yeah, if you have any questions, please feel free to chime in. I'm sure Holden knows like the back of her hand.
I have.
I do
knowledge.
Actually. Yeah. I do know this story very
yeah,
well.
Yeah, so that's perfect. That helps me out. Holden will be able to jump in and correct
again.
Me anytime I make a mistake. Obviously, like Holden said, she likes to be very prepared, and so do I. And obviously, we were given such short notice.
Thanks
by
a lot, producer.
Yeah. So I blame all of the inaccuracies of this episode solely on this man's shoulders. Okay.
Yep.
To start,
take it up with him.
To start,
I believe in you, man. I trust you.
Elizabeth Short was found dead in a lot on January 15, 1947 in Los Angeles, California. And if you've seen her body, not only was her body positioned where her legs were out, her arms were up and kind of, like elbows a little bit tucked in like this, but her body was cut in half. And you would think if her body's cut in half, oh my God, there's a ton of blood.
Yeah.
No. The blood was drained from her body. And not only that, They also, while she was alive, after, you know, during the autopsy, they found that while she was alive is when there were cuts essentially made in her mouth, about 3 inches is what they said, 2 to 3 inches. So essentially think of like the Joker, you know how the Joker cut kind of to like that smiling face. Is essentially how her body was found. And it was found by a woman who was just walking, you know, doing running errands, you know, 10 o'clock in the morning.
With her baby,
I think with like her granddaughter or something like that, trying to get her shoes fixed. She was headed to a shoe repair shop and she runs into this and just goes about her day. And, you know, obviously runs, calls in, you know, a neighbor and reports it. So that, but it's just it's just horrific scene to just kind of randomly walk up to.
She said she thought it was a mannequin at first.
She said the body was so white and pale that she thought it was a mannequin. She didn't think it was real. Mm-hmm. That's just crazy to think about that. That's how, like, he drained the, you know, the killer drained the blood out of the individual. So just if you just look at this, you're thinking, man, you know, this individual, you know, the autopsy shows, you know, that it must be someone with some sort of surgical skills, mm-hmm. is what they believe. Yeah. So an individual who has some sort of, you know, background in medicine or, you know, essentially in that field. But let's talk about Elizabeth Short herself. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of a, you know, background about Elizabeth Short. And so she is from Massachusetts is where she's from. And you're wondering, she's from Massachusetts, how did she get to L.A.? Well, like many people moved to L.A. As starving actresses, essentially. And so she worked, obviously, tons of jobs. There were some issues, you know, with her, you know, in regards to her family kind of growing up and with her father. And he essentially committed suicide. You know, they believed him to commit suicide after, you know, the stock market crashed in 1929, just, you know, before, you know, during the Great Depression. But what's odd was 12 years later, you know, just during her childhood, 12 years later, come to find out he's still alive and he's living in California. Writes them a letter saying, I'm still alive, live it. So he faked his suicide. He faked his death. And he's out in California. And so, you know, shortly after, they continue living their lives. And as soon as she turned 18, because she wanted to become an actress, she said, you know what, I'm moving in with my dad. I'm moving to California. And so she goes out, she leaves, goes to California, stays with her dad. And she essentially, a month after she stayed with her dad, you know, she decided to leave. She said, you know, I can't stay with you any longer. Like, this is just not working. And so she goes on, and obviously, you know, she's living place to place. And she was even supposed to marry this individual who's who was fighting in World War II. So she was supposed to marry this officer. And her fiance actually died in a plane crash, in a second plane crash. So he was in one plane crash. I think her first...
Yeah, two plane crashes?
Yeah, it was two plane crashes. He died in a second
plane. What a lucky guy.
God. Kill me in the first one. Which is... two times.
Oh, my God. Absolutely insane.
What the heck?
But, yeah, so... So what's odd about all this is that... So, you know, obviously they found her dead in an open lot. They're like, okay, well, what can we do? You know, how... You know, essentially trying to find what were her last steps. Mm-hmm. Who was she last seen with? So on and so forth. And so she was last seen at a hotel in downtown Los Angeles called the Bitmore Hotel, is what it was called. Mm-hmm. And she was accompanied by a friend or someone or, you know, an acquaintance that she had. Robert Red Manley is his name. And she actually, they just came back from a short trip in San Diego that they had with one another.
Okay.
And so she was, you know, she got dropped off there. And, you know, Robert went on and went back, I believe it was back to San Diego. And what was odd about this was, I believe it was 9 days after her body was found is when there was letters being sent to the examiner. And essentially what was happening was the letters had some, those type of, you know, whenever someone dies or whatever, and someone's trying to, you know, where there's like different, like, you know, magazine clippings of different words, all different sizes and so on and so forth.
I don't know what it's called, but I know they do that. The letter, the ransom letters.
So it's essentially said, here is the Black Dahlia's belongings. And it was like her purse, a phone book with, or like an address book, phone book with like a few pages ripped out and so on and so forth. And what was odd about the few pages being ripped out is someone said, that it's got to be someone she knows.
That, yeah.
Yeah.
That
so, because, like, you know, you don't rip out random pages for no reason. It's got, like, you know, it makes sense that maybe they're trying to rip out some information, and if they just ripped out one page, it's odd. If they ripped out a few more pages, okay, it's like.
So, these items were sent to?
They were sent to the examiner's office. Ah. And so then Rob, the guy who last dropped her off, he, you know, they found a couple of her belongings in a bag, you know, not too far from her body. And he went on and he confirmed that those are her items. And I believe it was like a dress and like a shoe or something like that, that it was her purse and her shoe. I mean, if they confirmed, and, you know, they confirmed that it was her belongings. But all of this, it's like, so, you know, obviously the first thing you try to do is you figure out, okay, who could it possibly be? The last person she's seen with is Robert Ed Manley. So they go in and so they interview several people. I think it was like 75 people is who they interviewed during this process. And Robert Red was one of the first ones that they interviewed. And they actually, so what happened was he took a polygraph exam. Because what was odd was he confessed to the murder. He said, yes, I killed her. It was me. So on and so forth.
The man that was with her.
The man that last dropped her off at the hotel. Robert Red. Okay. Yeah. Oh, I'm going to call him Red Manley going forward. So he confessed. Yeah. He confessed to the murder. He said, okay, it was me who murdered her. So on and so forth. And they're wondering, like, okay, so let's take a polygraph test. So he took a polygraph examination. And all of a sudden, he was clear. You know, he passed the polygraph exam without a hitch. And he also had an alibi. And they even went around a second time and they actually used a truth serum or sodium pentothal or something like that. They used truth serum, what they believed to be truth serum at the time, and he passed again that time without a hitch. So they're like, no, this guy has an alibi, passes polygraph exams, like he's clear, he's not in the, like we can rule him out as number one suspect.
What do you think his motivation was for lying about killing her?
So what I guess he didn't really have, there wasn't really a motivation, but something that not only his wife noticed, you know, years down, was he had mental health issues. So then he was essentially admitted into a facility. And once he was admitted to the facility, you know, he left. He was living out in California. And actually, he even committed suicide a day after or like almost 30 years later or 29 or 30 years later, a day after Elizabeth Short died. The Black Dahlia was dead.
The anniversary,
essentially. Yeah. Spooky. So because he had those mental health issues, why they believe that he went on and he confessed and so on and so forth. And obviously, I believe he was a soldier as well, so which may have kind of contributed to that as well. And so that's number one big suspect right there. The next really big suspect, you know, after, you know, they go through all these individuals, was someone named George Hodel. So George Hodel, he was a physician. He went to med school, so that, you know, that kind of relates back to what the coroner said, saying so it has to be someone with some sort of surgical skills. Mm-hmm. So this individual, George Hodel, was a physician at a venereal disease clinic. He went to med school to become a surgeon, and you know he opted to go elsewhere. But what was really odd about this was that it was, you know, years later, his son came out and actually was the one who said, I believe it may have been my dad. So his son, Steve Hodel, was a former Los Angeles police detective. So his son worked for the police. Yeah. So worked for the police department. And after he retired, you know, doing some consulting, he found that he was like, yo, you know what? I believe this may have been my dad. And they're like, okay, well, what's your proof? Why do you believe it to be your dad? Well, firstly, his dad, you know, is a doctor, has some sort of, is a physician, has some surgeon skills to start. Secondly, I believe it was maybe about 50 days after Elizabeth Short died, his dad actually fled America, went to the Philippines, which is another red flag. You know, someone, you know, one of the suspects fleeing America. Mm. And lastly, or not lastly, but another really big piece that I found was, you know, when, you know, his son is essentially digging up all this evidence, working with the DA's office, so on and so forth, they found out that the authorities were essentially recording his dad at the time. Okay. So they were recording his dad for about 40 days. They were able to get recording devices inside his home for roughly 40 days, and the authorities at the time cleared him. And so people are wondering, how did the authorities clear him when he said this? And I'm going to quote, supposing I did kill the Black Dahlia, they couldn't prove it now. they can't talk to my secretary because she's dead, is what he said in one of the recordings. So you're thinking, okay, well, this guy, you know, no, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. This is the man who did it, without a shadow of a doubt. But what's odd about it is he's saying that because they can't talk to his secretary. Come to find out, his secretary actually died 2 years prior to the Black Dahlia dying, Elizabeth Short. And his secretary, he was actually a suspect in that case as well. They believed him to have killed the secretary because he was covering up financial fraud. And he also had a lot of this information, a lot of this, you know, secrets about a lot of these policemen and politicians. And so they're saying, oh, it may have been because of some of those secrets that he had that he was able to essentially kind of buy off, you know, some of these dirty cops and dirty politicians.
Makes a lot of sense.
And so it just kind of all ties in. And it's just so odd that it's all kind of worked out. And people are wondering, well, why is his son coming out and saying this? Does he have some sort of vendetta? Is there some sort of agenda that's kind of going on? And come to find out, George Hodel was a terrible father. So essentially he would, you know, when you know, Steve Hodel actually has a sister, I believe her name is Tamar, and he essentially would, his father, when she was much younger, I think 11 years old, 11, 14, he would pimp her out. So if his friends would come over, he'd pimp her out, she'd sleep with, you know, so on and so forth. He taught her how to, you know, do oral sex at 11. You're teaching a child.
Where is the mom?
Yeah.
With daddy me. So. That kid me. Like, I'm in, bro. What
so,
the heck?
So what's odd about this is, so essentially George Hodel, he had many children with many women. So he was a man, he was hot shit, essentially. You know what I mean? Big time doctor, making all this money, women throwing themselves at him. And so one thing that his son also had, actually, let me go back to about his daughter. So essentially, he, you know, pimping his daughter out, so on and so forth. And at 14, supposedly is when, you know, they said that he even raped his daughter. And, you know, he was suspected then. Their family came out and said, yo, you know what? This man, there's no way his daughter is lying. His family members came out. And they're like, man, like, that's insane. So the daughter is lying.
Yo, I put my money on this guy now.
It's what they, yeah,
I'm
so
thinking
it's
him too.
It's what they believe to be. But come to find out, obviously, he's the breadwinner of the family. Mm-hmm. He's, you know, obviously taking care of a lot of these family members. They're going to come out in his defense, mm-hmm, to clear him. So he was cleared of any of these, you know, rape allegations and sexual assault, essentially.
This is really bad police work.
Oh, it's
like really bad police work.
The police is absolutely crooked at this time. Yeah. It's crooked. Like, you know, you can buy them all.
So this is 1947?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. Yes. This is in 1947, correct. And it's just terrible. And you hear so much things about, you know, obviously, you know, some of the incompetence and just some of the, you know, bribery and so on and so forth that's going on in the police departments at that time. And even, you know, till this day, probably. It's just absolutely terrible. But essentially, you know, a year later, you know, his daughter turns 15 and she gives birth. She gives birth to her baby girl. So if you kind of look
to
at the timeline.
To her father's daughter.
Yeah, yeah.
Pack it up.
Yeah, yeah. Not only is he your dad, he's also your granddad. You know, is what they believe to be.
What the heck?
Which is just absolutely crazy. That's but
so messed up.
She so essentially, she went on and she gave the child up for adoption. And the child is living with a family in Nebraska, I believe it is. And you know, she found out years and years later that, oh my God, there's a connection to my dad. It's just, mm-hmm, I could only imagine, you know, her life and kind of what she's thinking about. But to get back to the story, another reason why his son believes, Steve Hodel, but then saying that it is because of that it may be due to, you know, a little bit of vendetta. He, you know, a little bit of hate towards his dad that he believes that this may be the case. Mm-hmm. But what's odd is that he actually, in his family photo album, he found pictures of Elizabeth Short in the family photo album. And he takes it to, you know, essentially like a photography expert who can kind of see, you know, some of the resemblance. And after looking at Elizabeth Short in one of her photos and also looking at the photo inside the family photo album, he believes there to be at least a 90% match that this is Elizabeth Short in the family photo album, which is just
insane.
Yeah, it's insane to think about. So not only do you have, you know, this individual, George Hodel, has a skill, number one, medical, he's surgeon skill. Number two, confession. There's a connection because now you see that George Hodel, you know, has her in the family photo album, so he must know her. Probably one of the names that was ripped out of the you know address book when it was initially handed in, and that he, you know, he may have, you know, she may have been one of the women he was seeing at the time. And so this is just absolutely crazy.
Can I ask?
Yeah, of course.
So all the evidence that you said have said so like, yeah. thus far, it seems. I mean. Like, I can see why it would lead people to believe that yeah. he was a terrible guy. It could lead people to believe that maybe he Correct. Did kill her. But, like, the evidence seems kind of circumstantial. It you is, know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And is there like, a piece of evidence that's, like, hard-hitting that, you that, know?
So, one thing that they found was they actually found a fingerprint in an envelope. Mm-hmm. And it was from one of the letters of the Black Dahlia killer, or the Black Dahlia Avenger is what they called themselves. And that fingerprint was ran through the system, but it was never connected to anyone. So that's that one hard piece of evidence that they had, mm-hmm. but they simply can't connect to anyone. They never took his fingerprints. And another thing that's very odd was when he actually moved to the Philippines years, I think he moved to the Philippines in like, you know, shortly after. But one of the odd things is in 1967, there was someone who died in the Philippines. His son, you know, found out that someone who died in the Philippines essentially the same way that the Black Dahlia died, with their body cut in half, so on and so forth,
serial blood killer. Drain. Yeah, believe it now.
It was a half mile from where his father lived, and also in an empty lot. So people are like, okay, well, this has got to be the guy. There's no way this is a mystery.
I'm curious who the other suspects are now.
Yeah,
so there's a ton of other suspects that they looked through. Obviously, this guy's
the reigning champion so far.
Yeah, I believe who? There was
this guy. Like, I'm talking about, like, no, the...
Oh,
yeah,
man.
George Hodel.
Yeah, he's the champion. Mm-hmm. Like, he's...
Yeah, he did it.
Yeah, he's like, it's just... But, you know, there's even a DA or district attorney, when I say DA... who said, like, they would, you know, without a shadow of a doubt, they would pin it on him and they would. But obviously, there's still no legit evidence to connect, you know, all this to George Hodel. And so it's still, you know, to this day is an unsolved mystery, unfortunately.
Do you think George Hodel?
Yeah.
Do you think he did it?
Without a shadow of a doubt. Oh. It's got to be him. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like 16 stuff pointed towards him.
Yeah. Because obviously when you hear the story about, you know, what happened with his sister and that's his dad, like you can understand maybe that, okay, well, this is a little fishy. Right. But when you just kind of look at it, just, you know, if you even take that part away, you take that kind of bias away, you just see, first of all, she's in a family photo album. Questionable. His dad... you know, had some sort of surgeon skill. He had his dad, you know, went to med school to do surgery. Mm-hmm. That's another red flag.
Another death, similar
death.
The secretary issue
that, yeah. and the comment that he made to that. Also, there was a ton of bags, that his dad brought, like I believe that had cement or something like that in it. And supposedly one of those bags was found near her body in the lot, which he believed that he used that bag to actually drop her off there. So it's like there's all these things that's kind of pointing to him.
Yo. Did he live near the lot?
I'm not 100% sure, but I don't know if he lived close to the lot. I don't think so.
Okay.
He had a pretty big house, and I believe his son even would like to go out, and he believes there to be human remains because there was a dog who came by and searched, and they believe there to be that there were human remains in his old childhood home or George Hedo's home at the time. But now, unfortunately, the individual who owns the place doesn't, you know, isn't giving them permission to go back and do a proper search. So
interesting.
No, this all is very, very odd, and I feel like it's just, come on, guys. It's not even, it's gotta be this guy.
Yeah,
100%.
Why is it unsolved?
I'm more convinced. I was about to say the Yeti, but nah, it's this guy.
Yeah. Listen, I'm not even going to circle back to that, but I don't think it's out of the realm of possibility.
Yeah.
I think it could happen. But this guy, he did it.
He definitely did it.
Yeah, it's about the Yeti, but we know that this guy did it.
The Yeti is questionable, very, very questionable.
That's you guys.
But no, definitely. Yeah, and so obviously, you know, the comment that he made about the secretary. Yeah. The secretary knew her. So it's possible the secretary knew her and they knew their relationship, which is possible as well. But it's mind-blowing that, you know,
one thing that really the final nail in the coffin for me was the similar death
Philippines. You're telling me the same thing happened thousands of miles away. Like, come, it's got to be this guy.
100%.
Wow.
Thank you for that, Haji. I like that story. I didn't know that many details.
Yeah, no, the Black Dahlia, obviously, it's a very interesting case. Wow. Mm-hmm. You can continue. You could, you know, look at some more information, like some of the other suspects that they interviewed and that they believed to be. But, yeah, it's a super fascinating case, big Hollywood case. I believe it was on the front page of, like, the L.A. Times or whatever, like, their newspaper for, like, over a month. You know what I mean? Because this is, yeah.
It's horrific to be sawed in half and left on the street.
Sawed in half. And blood drained.
And then blood drained. Yeah, and then you're
smile, essentially. The cut Joker. Like the Joker. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Absolutely crazy. Absolutely crazy.
That was, wow, that's.
Thanks for that, Haji.
But no, it's absolutely one murder mystery, both unsolved mysteries.
Both unsolved.
One is pretty cool. Yeah, one I think we have the answer to. It's got to be the Yeti, I feel like.
I'm more confused.
It has to be the Yeti. Thank you. Yeah. Finally.
It's not the Yeti.
I think it's
the KGB.
The KGB, the military experiment.
Yeah,
that makes a lot of sense. It makes a lot of sense, but. And
the reason the reason I'm saying that is because, first of all, is the radioactive thing sold me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The radioactive. Another question I have is, in that location they have, because these guys were hiking, in that specific radius that they would have covered, was there anything like that nuclear power plant or?
Well, she mentioned that that was some of the testing site.
It's a testing site, but it's not, there's no power plants, there's no civilization.
Yeah.
It's literally one of the most remote places in the world, you know? Basically, not towards the top peak of a mountain. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So there's nothing there.
Okay. That's so odd. But no, hopefully you guys enjoyed this episode of Unsolved Mysteries.
I did.
Yeah,
I was representing the audiences that know about these stories.
Ask the questions, chime in from time to time.
We appreciate you. Much needed, absolutely.
Yeah. But again, guys, thank you so much. Please make sure to like, comment, share, and subscribe.
Tell a friend.
To tell a friend.
Exactly. That's what it is.
Tell their mama.
Yeah.
All right? This is what we got to.
This episode was Uki Spooky.
Spooky. Again, guys, hopefully y'all enjoyed it. Take it easy.
See you guys soon.